That was perfect timing because it's the amount of time it took me to find the record button is what you use to get water. So that was really good. It's actually recording now, so that's perfect.
Great.
Okay, perfect. Okay, well, thanks for this, Ryan. Really appreciate it. And
Yeah, man, great to be here.
yeah, I think what I'd like to know is kind of just a bit more about what you're up to with SparkToro, because I'm obviously fully aware of kind of what you were doing in your Moz days and everything else and kind of the history behind it. And I'd say, actually, just to start this, kind of I was always a big fan of yours. So I got into SEO in 2003 and
Nice.
I really got kind of knees deep in SEO in 2006. And that was the year I honestly read every one of your blog posts on Moz. It was like, that was the thing that was the make sure I must read all of the time. And yeah, I think that actually might be quite a good intro to this because it's all about personal branding, how you can show that you have or build more influence with your opinions. And yeah, I think what you're up to with SparkToro in terms of the influence side of things is really good. So yeah, I think it'd be interesting to see what you're up to, maybe show us some of the tools that you have,
Yeah.
and then just have a chat, really. Yeah.
Sounds great. Yeah. 2000. So 2003. I think that is the second. That's like 1 year after I got into SEO, which was 02.
Okay.
But I think the SEO Moz blog, I didn't start until like the end of 03, start of 04. So
Yeah.
that was like right at the very beginning. Look at us, old school.
I remember there was something you did. I think it was a Moz Pro feature that you used to send a very short tip quite frequently. And I remember they were great. It was like these little nuggets of gold and stuff like
Yeah.
that. So, yeah, no, I do remember that from a long time ago. That's
Yeah, the little, I think it was like the SEO Moz Pro tips. I
it,
remember
yeah.
those too. Yeah, that was way back in the day. I think that was before we did like the Q&A section and all that kind of stuff. And
I probably was. Yeah, no, it's definitely a long time ago, but I remember there was a lot of value in that.
yeah. So no, I mean with SparkToro, it's in a way it is trying to help a similar group of people, right? Like a lot of web marketers, obviously, but also folks in the kind of market research and audience research and founders of companies, entrepreneurs, right? People who want to build things, creatives, those types of folks as well. And yeah, I mean, I think I would say the company in a way is almost like an extension of something that I want to see more of in the world, which is, after Moz, which is like a company that's heavily reliant on Google and helping people rank in Google and get traffic from Google. I kind of had this, I don't know, I became disillusioned with everything that Google does and keeps doing. And same with Facebook, right? And like these two companies kind of own so much of the internet's advertising dollars and marketers' attention. And I don't think that's good. I don't think
No.
that's good for us. I don't think it's good for the world. I don't think it's good for economies. I don't think it's good for income inequality. I don't think it's good for politics. I don't think it's good for information transfer. Like it's just every vector I can possibly think of, it's bad. It's not even great for innovation. Like Facebook and Google in the last 5 or 6 years have not innovated the way they did in their first 10, 15 years.
Sure.
And so, now it's just like, how do we extract more dollars from our advertisers as opposed to, hey, let's build Google Maps. Hey, let's build Project Fi. Hey, let's, build something really incredible. There's less and less of that and more and more, hey, let's lobby Europe so they pass this crazy GDPR law that makes sure no European company can ever compete with us.
I know what you mean. I remember I gave an opinion, and this is potentially 10 years ago, but it was my answer to the question about how Google are going to grow was they've reached market share. So it's no longer less about how you get more users and be the best search engine for the users. It's more about how you monetize. And I
Yeah.
think that's the problem. Now they have so much control. It's
No,
tricky. Yeah.
I think that's absolutely right. Like Google's two options are basically compete with the people who are creating for the web, mm-hmm. or innovate in completely new ways. And I think they've, for better or worse, you know, just sort of run out of a lot of those ideas on the compete in new ways. And, you know, they've shut down a lot of their labs projects, a lot of their, you know, the 20% time, the innovation stuff. Yeah. And so now they just kind of buy or, oh, hey, Kevin, it looks like you've got some interesting content there. We'll just take that now. That's ours now. Oh, did you want that? No, yeah. When you let us crawl your website, you gave up all your copyright and trademark law. You're a sucker.
Yeah, exactly. No, that's right. And I think going back to your point in terms of what you're trying to build, the way I understand it is from a marketing perspective, if you're, let's say you're a market leader in any space, normally it's a game of brute force media. You've got the biggest budgets. They're not always the smartest, most innovative. They might have the smartest people, but if you've got the biggest budget, you normally plow it into ads and you win kind of that way. Yep. I think it sounds like what you're talking about is actually how can you be the underdog and win? Like how can you take what you're doing and perform and amplify what you're doing so much more? Because like the example of being, if you're creating content and reading an article or you're a social influencer, that's going to get so much more eyeballs and attention than the ad that is on the side of that, surely. So that's where you really want to be.
Yeah, I think there's, you know, part of it is that way. And part of it is also the distribution of media and advertising dollars and marketing time and attention, yep. right? So whereas that currently flows almost exclusively to Google and Facebook, mm-hmm. my thought is that, you know, marketers like us, if we are presented with, hey, your audience pays attention to this, they all listen to this podcast, they all subscribe to this email newsletter, they go to this event, they read this website, they follow these people on social. Well, now we can go, instead of spending dollars with Google and Facebook, we can go spend dollars and effort pitching that podcast and sponsoring them and advertising directly on that website and doing some co-marketing with that organization and sponsoring that event. And what happens? Those dollars, instead of going, you know, getting locked into, you know, Google's massive vault of dollars, they go back into the small and medium business economy. They go mm-hmm. back into the web ecosystem. They turn into more good stuff. They turn into more companies. They turn into more innovative projects. They turn into maybe potentially something that someday disrupts Google and Facebook. That excites me.
I like right that now. Actually. I think it might have been James Altucher that he was saying, if you spend money locally, that dollar isn't a dollar in the economy, it's five, because then that local person goes and spends something else locally, etc. Whereas if you exactly just give right. it to the corporates, then
yeah. I mean, this is one of the big problems with, you know, income inequality is sort of a problem on its own, right? It's a problem because so few people have so much wealth and everybody else gets nothing. But it's also a problem because it doesn't create growth for anybody, right? Because when billionaires keep their billions of dollars, right? Jeff Bezos is sort of a drain on the world yeah. because he doesn't spend his money. Like you and I, we order takeout. We will spend, if we spend, you know, whatever, we order Indian tomorrow night, mm-hmm. we're going to spend more of our net worth than Jeff Bezos will spend in the next century. Right? Boom.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, and that's really what you want to create a thriving economic model, right? Is those dollars going back into the world, back into creation of more opportunities and wealth and distribution of opportunity. That's a beautiful thing. And so SparkToro, look, I mean, it's a company, right? It's a software product. But the idea behind it is that as a marketer or researcher, you can find exactly what any audience pays attention to, and then hopefully go, you know, do three things really intelligently. One, build up your resiliency, mm-hmm. right? Because reliance on Google and Facebook means that anytime Google and Facebook get pissed at you, right, and pull their advertising dollars, or they don't like what you're doing, or whatever, oh, yeah. you violate some terms of use that you didn't even know about, they could take that away. So you're building up resiliency. Second, you are building strength on those platforms. Google and Facebook's ranking signals, right? The things that make their algorithms run are whether you are an engaging brand that draws clicks and visibility and engagement from people who see what you're up to, mm-hmm. right? Google's ranking is dependent on you getting more clicks than your competitors, right? And Facebook's engagement rate is based on you being more engaging than what everybody else is doing. And a lot of the ads, the ad ROI is driven by you having a more engaging ad, and that means having a brand that more people know. And then third, yeah, it's awesome, right? You get to participate in this sort of small and medium business economy that's good for the world. So that, you know, that's where SparkToro is trying to help.
I like that. That's a really good cause. And to be honest, externally, I hadn't even considered what you're saying about just where the money flows and the corporates. So no, I think it's interesting to see what's at the inside of a company and what you're doing, like more of a purpose for you,
yeah,
what you're trying to build. So no, that's great.
I mean, you know, if I don't know if you follow me on Twitter, Kevin, but
yeah,
you know, anybody who does would be like, okay, it feels like Rand is interested in, I don't know what to call it, like just a lot of purpose-driven stuff, right? That gets me excited. That gets me interested. Money alone is not going to do the trick.
Like, isn't. Exactly.
You know, it's not going to get me out of bed.
It's also the sort of thing that I'd like to think, if you're doing the right thing, hopefully the money will flow in a way that rewards you. But equally, if you're just chasing the money, is that rewarding in itself? Yeah.
I mean, if you're just chasing the money, I feel like in marketing, the way to do that, I don't know if you have a strong opinion on this, but there's these weird people who leverage their kind of personal brand to become like marketing gurus, and then they sell courses and they sell membership to like exclusive groups and that kind of thing. And that, I agree, that world is very lucrative. You can make a ton of money. You don't have to put in a ton of work. You know, you sort of make one or two information products and you sell them with a bunch of hooks and psychological tricks, and you can make a lot of money. And I don't know, but that, I don't feel like that does enough for the world. I don't feel like it gets me excited. And I feel like there's just a scummy sort of sleaziness to it.
I know what you mean. It almost reminds me of the days of when you had a get rich quick scheme, and there's a guy who's rented a Ferrari for an hour and it stood next to
it. It feels like the Tony Robbins thing, you know, like, let's go to a seminar. We're going to get really pumped up and excited. And everybody loves him. And he's like transforming your life. And also he's being abusive to women and maybe like indoctrinating you into this weird cult phenomenon. And like, you know, and you only find out about that stuff years later.
Yeah, exactly. No. So yeah, I think do the right thing is definitely a good way forward.
My hope, obviously, right? My hope for SparkToro is we raised money for it, right? We raised non-venture capital, but we raised money for it from mostly folks like yourself, right? Like a lot of marketers and agency owners and stuff. And my hope is that we're a fantastic investment for them. Like, I hope that in 10 years they look back and go, wow, that was better than my stock portfolio. Like, I'm so glad I put money into SparkToro. I would love that, right? That would be a wonderful thing. So I don't mean to say that I'm not a capitalist, or, you know, not someone who believes in, you know, turning effort and dollars into more, but I think that, I guess I'm a capitalist who believes that well-regulated, very distributed capitalism is great, and poorly regulated, concentrated capitalism is pretty terrible.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, because it's definitely not about lacking ambition and wanting to achieve anything in any way. It's just how that distribution happens off the back of it, I guess. So,
Yeah, exactly. Right. Like, I mean, this is like a personal preference thing, but I like it philosophically, but I also like it personally. Like, I don't know where you're, Kevin, where are you based in the UK?
Based in Oxford, actually, just outside of London.
Oh, yeah. We visited a few years ago. It's lovely.
Yeah, it's very nice.
We got to like took a tour of the college and everything. But so, you know, there, Oxford has whatever, Starbucks and Greg's and, you know, whatever, you know, the same 10 places, Nando's, right? That you can find in every British town, right?
Sure. Yeah.
And I don't like going to any of those. Like that's not an enjoyable, interesting experience. I like going to this one woman runs this amazing fish and chip shop, and like, you know, she has one of the best fish and chips in the UK. And like, I love that place, right? I love the, oh yeah, this guy moved here from Italy a few years ago and he opened his own espresso place, and it's only open for like 2.5 hours between on Monday between, you know, noon and three because it's Italian, but it's amazing coffee. Like, I want to go to that place. Not to rag on the Italians, but you know,
It feels like you've traveled. You go to a Nando's in every country.
So no, we have traveled to Italy. Geraldine, my wife, is Italian. But no, I've been reading about, because I want to, as soon as COVID lifts or whatever, I'm hoping that we can go try living in Italy for a little while, just experiment with it. And so I was reading all these articles about like, oh, what's it like living in Italy? And the biggest frustration Americans seem to have is nothing is ever open.
Oh, really? I guess, yeah, it's not the 24/7 world. So
no. And Italy, you know, Italy doesn't really do chains either. So I think that's actually a beautiful thing. Like, I love that idea of a sort of capitalist world where there's not, you know, a few dominant players who run everything, right? There's no like national coffee chain. There's no national sandwich shop, I guess, except for Auto Grill. But right. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's really nice. I like that. Do you want to show us some examples of just how the tool works?
Sure.
Yeah.
That could be fun. All right. Oh, I think you need to enable my screen sharing.
Oh, this could be tricky.
Let's see. I'm going to pop over to SparkToro here.
Perfect.
And let's see. So you may need to make me a co-host or a presenter or something like that.
I'm not quite sure what that setting is, honestly. And it might not, I'm not the admin on this account. I've got a horrible feeling I might not be able to do this.
How to make someone a co-host on Zoom. There we go. All right, boom. In the host controls, click manage. This will open the participants list. Hover over the name of the participant and click make host.
I don't have a button that says manage because I'm not the admin.
Do you have a button that is host controls?
Unfortunately not, no.
All right. Looks like there's another way to do it, which is, what is this? On the schedule options, I think you have to do that beforehand. Oh, I think you might be able to just right click on me and click make host or co-host.
Yeah, got it. You should be a co-host now.
Sweet. All right, look at us.
That's
what with
that's
our ability to search Google images.
It's amazing.
All right, let's see here. So I'm gonna go and my wife is trying to get my attention, but she does not realize that this is recorded for posterity.
I just think it's funny that you guys are bragging about how you're able to make the technology work when that is literally your job.
So here we are. This is the section of the show where they show off SparkToro. So that's going to be a great intro.
This is Rand doing his job.
Yeah. Rand does not know how to make things work. No, let's see. So basically, so what SparkToro is, right, fundamentally, Kevin, it's this giant database of profiles, what we call profiles. And so you can see the this sort of number here, right, that's that keeps growing.
Yeah.
And the idea with our profile is we'll be like, oh, here's Kevin Gibbons's, here's your website, right? Here's your website about page. Mm-hmm. Here's that links to a LinkedIn profile, which links to a Twitter page, which links to a Pinterest, which links to and here's your Reddit, and here's your YouTube, here's your Instagram, here's your Facebook, right? We have these sort of 10 social networks.
Right.
And website about pages. And we consider that one profile.
Yeah.
Right. So we don't have obviously all of those networks for everybody. And we probably will miss some networks for some people because you don't you know, I don't link to my Reddit profile anywhere, right? So SparkToro can't find my Reddit profile associated with me, but we do have these for a ton of folks. And so when you search, right? So if I go in here and I search for, all right, let's search for espresso. My audience talks about espresso makers. Let's see, I haven't actually done that search before, but since it was relevant to us.
Yeah, sure.
All right, so here we can see that Amazon giveaway, coffee time, chocolate, freebie Friday. Okay, so a lot of like giveaway folks in the people who talk about espresso makers. So essentially what's happening here is that over the last 120 days, SparkToro's database of 75 million profiles saw 3,400-ish people that talked about espresso makers on one of their social networks, one or more of their social networks, usually 2 to 4 or more times. So right. when we're talking about frequently talks about, we do that. And so then there's all these attributes about those people, right? So a lot, you know, a small 7.6% of them have followed or engaged with or commented on or replied to something from this specialty coffee association,
right?
And 7.1% engage with Barista Magazine. Like, no surprise, right? These look like the types of things you would do. But to be honest, before SparkToro, how would you ever get that number? Like, I don't really know of another way on the internet or at all to get the number of like, oh, which publications? I don't care about how big they are. I don't care about how big their audience is. I care about how much they resonate with this particular group. And so if you are trying to reach, you know, whatever it is, I want chemical engineer, people with the job title chemical engineer who are located in the UK, which I have no idea anything about them. that, you know, that group is going to be, so we don't have a ton of profiles, only 86 of them, but there's lots of, like, I don't know this Chemical Engineer magazine or CERN or WISE, but these all sound super credible, right? If I had some new product that I was trying to reach this group with, that's pretty sweet, right?
That's where your potential customers are, I guess. It's knowing where do they hang out online? How do you get in front of them?
Yep, exactly, right? And so I might then say like, oh, wow, okay. Well, I see that these chemical engineers, the small numbers of them who are there, right, talk about these things and they have these words in their bio and here's their distribution of where they're located, right, in the UK. And okay, oh, look, a bunch of them talk about process safety. Let's look at people who talk about process safety. That sounds like a group that exactly describes who I want to go after.
Right.
And we can drill down to the UK. We could drill down to Oxford if you wanted to. Potentially see, okay, so another really sizable, similarly sizable, 3,400 people who talk about process safety and are in the UK. And here's what they talk about, which looks like it's a mix of media and sort of politics. What's Private Eye Magazine?
I don't actually know. Yeah, Current Affairs.
Okay, I was a little nervous that I was about to click on like the British version of Playboy or something.
Oh, right, no. it does sound like it could be.
Right? Like it's Private Eyes. I don't know. Do you want to click that?
From years ago, but I didn't even know that was still a thing, honestly.
Yeah, okay. So it sounds like Britain's best-selling news and current affairs magazine with a mix of jokes and investigative journalism. Sure, okay. So potentially, right, I could then go, oh, do I want to advertise on this website? Do I want to run targeted ads against it on whatever, YouTube or Facebook or Google Display Network or Instagram or what have you, right? And then, did these look like the people I want to reach? Less so, like this is not the engineering group. So even though UK process engineers might be reading it, I don't think this is the audience for me, right? And so I might instead choose some of those more relevant ones and go after them instead. But this, you know, this gives you sort of a sense of like, oh yeah, there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of detail and data. We do websites and social, but we also do, you know, podcasts that resonate with folks. We'll show YouTube channels that are popular with them. We will show, you can go into the social and websites and do, you know, instead of all the accounts, we could go after only sort of hidden gems, which are accounts that have high engagement rates or high relative engagement rates to their follower sizes. Yep. So usually smaller accounts with higher engagement. And this is mostly used by marketers for, you know, better ad targeting, going to Facebook ads. I don't know if you've seen the latest Facebook ad builder, but my God, they've taken away all the intelligence so that you bid as broadly as you possibly can. Right. And SparkToro is sort of nice, right? Because you can go dig back in and be like, oh, wait a minute. You know, for example, you know, you might say like, oh, my audience follows a social account. Let me see, what was a recent search that I was helping someone with? Sure, oh, they were trying to find CMOs, right? And so they were looking for people who follow the Adobe CMO account, and I can potentially take these, you know, attributes, these words and phrases that appear in their bios, these hashtags they use, the accounts they follow, and I can plug that into my Facebook or Google ads and get much more targeted, detailed audiences that actually are the ones that I want to go after.
Right.
But I could then also, right, apart from just that, a lot of our customers are using them directly to do outreach, right? To say like, oh, sweet. Yeah. Let me, you know, give me Adweek and give me Forrester and yeah, give me Ann Handley and ooh, Content Marketing Institute, the CMO Network from Forbes. Maybe not VentureBeat, maybe click, yep, Gartner, right? And then I could say, yeah, that's my crowd. That's who I want to go after. Give me CMO outreach list. I'm going to create that. Mm-hmm. And then I could pop over to that list and go, cool, you know, let me get the contact info for these different publications and reach out to them and do whatever kind of marketing I want to do with them, right?
Yep. Yeah, so that's where it blends into maybe the organic side as well, is can you write an article for them? And I don't mean in a guest blogging style way, but more adding value.
Yeah, no, but doing op-eds, right, is a huge, right? Because you can pitch Forrester on an op-ed.
Yeah.
That's pretty sweet.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and look, we have everyone's email address, which I've just made public, so I'll close that now.
Okay.
But yeah, so you click some of these and you'll get all the email addresses and Instagram and LinkedIn, et cetera, et cetera. So
that's really powerful, actually.
Yeah. So that is basically the product. I mean, there's a few more like features and details, right? There's filters in the sections. You can do comparisons of people. So you could do, you know, chemical engineering and aerospace engineering and compare those two against each other and get sort of, you know, Venn diagrams of that data, which I know some of the creative and digital agencies really like the just screenshot and put it in a presentation and then say like, I know you want to reach these two audiences and you can't reach them in the same place, right? So,
yeah.
Or you can, right? If they have those overlaps. This is a decent overlap for chemical engineering and aerospace, but there's lots of diverse differences too. So those kinds of things are all use cases. And then I'm seeing, you know, I've seen people do really creative, cool stuff with it. Like I talked to a podcaster the other day who was like, yeah, man, this is how I find my advertisers. I go and I look at who my audience is and then what else they follow. And I look for people with money that they follow and I reach out to them and I say, hey,
that's smart.
I'm reaching your audience with my podcast. You should come sponsor me.
That's
slick.
Yeah, I was even thinking about how you can use this the other way around. So like, I always think if you can build your own audience, that's more powerful than leveraging other audience in the long term. Sure. But it doesn't mean that you shouldn't leverage other audiences. You should definitely appear on podcasts or write in different places as well. But yeah. You could potentially flip this the other way. So if you're running a podcast, how do you find guests? Or
yes,
if you're running an event, how do you find speakers? It could be that type of thing that could potentially help you, I would assume, from the social side.
No, that's exactly right. You could, you know, if your podcast is about 3D printing, for example, mm-hmm. and you want to find, right, you could say, oh, I want to get guests who are going to bring me great people. You can go into the filters here in social and say, show me only individual people. It's not perfect, but it will generally show more people than businesses. So mm-hmm. and then you could be like, boom, Adam Savage. Can we get him on our podcast? Joel Telling, Joseph Prusa, Simone Gertz. I think Geraldine actually knows Simone. So there you go. Right. Like these are the people that you want to get on your 3D printing podcast because they will bring the audience that is interested in the right kinds of numbers.
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah. And maybe you appear on theirs, they appear on yours or however, but it's, I think that's a good way to source the list because otherwise I assume you'll get way more than I do, but I get quite a lot of requests over LinkedIn for, can you go on my podcast? And it's quite hard to figure out actually which ones I should say yes or no to, because you could be on a podcast all of the time. And a lot of them will have value, but at the same time, which are the ones, if you had a prioritized list, it would be easier to say, this is the one I really want to spend
some time. I mean, if someone's inviting you, first off, I like saying yes to almost all of those just because you never know how a podcast audience will grow over time.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
You know, potentially it might not reach the number or the people that you want today, but if it's relevant, that number could be much bigger in the future. And then the historical downloads start, right? So I like that. But you can certainly, right, go analyze any account. So you could say like, oh, you know, I don't know, what's that? Let's go find a 3D printing podcast. Sure. How about 3D printing today? That sounds like it's a real thing. Oops. Geez, it's tougher to find things in Google than you think. Okay, there we go. 3D printing today podcast. Mm-hmm. Great. Boom. Here it is. Let's go find the gotta hide that. All right, go back here at 3D printing today. My audience follows the social account 3D printing today. I think that was their social. So all right, this looks like a pretty relevant audience, right? Like I'd probably be willing to go on there, even though it looks like they only have, you know, maybe a few hundred downloads per episode. Mm-hmm. It still looks pretty relevant.
Yeah, and I think it's quite a niche subject. So actually getting in front of people who have that interest, it's more about targeting than numbers. So yeah.
Then again, I might be awful tempted to go after one of these other ones too.
Right? Yeah.
So, yeah. But that gives you sort of a sense of the product, right? And then it's got a dashboard that shows all your, you know, lists and previous queries and stuff like that, and you can share it with people. This is only live for a few folks right now, but you, to your point earlier around, hey, could you custom, like, could I take my audience and build that? You can basically take a list of social URLs, upload it to us, and then we'll analyze any custom audience you want.
Oh, okay, nice. Yeah.
Yeah, in the same sort of way. So yeah, that's basically SparkToro in a nutshell.
That's great. No, I can see how that's incredibly valuable, actually. And it's interesting to see from the advertiser side of actually how do you pick where the ad placement should be. And kind of to your earlier point, Google and Facebook will just want you to appear everywhere. Actually, what you want is to turn off all their default settings and laser focus and target on where the audience is. So,
No, absolutely, right? I think that if you can do better targeting than your competitors can in Google and Facebook, and frankly, you know, Twitter and LinkedIn and hell, TikTok and Snapchat, if you're doing those too, if you can get more more reach among a smaller but better targeted group, you're going to end up paying less. you will generally get higher click-through rates, and that will mean better return on investment for you. And so there is, you know, you can kind of get more value out of paid advertising through just that intelligence. And the frustrating part for us was like, geez, like Kevin, how would you do that, you know, 2-3 years ago? Like, what do you survey your customers and like try and ask them what they read and follow and pay attention to and ask them how they describe themselves? You know, that data is going to be, the surveys are awesome for a bunch of things. Like they're great for sentiment. They're great for like psychographic stuff. They're good for values stuff. They're good for like opinions about, a product or a brand, but they are lousy if you're going to ask people like, hey, what podcast do you listen to?
Yeah, I agree. Especially if it's some of the frustrating ones, or when you're trying to read a news article and they put a survey in front of you. I don't at least even read what that survey is. I'm just like, show me the article. That's what I'm here for. How can you trust that as a response?
I saw the greatest thing in Reddit today. It was someone who was like, it was one of the top posts on Reddit. And it was like, every time YouTube or Google asked me to fill out a survey, I always tell them that I'm familiar with brands I've never heard of, just to throw off their data.
Yeah.
I thought that was so great. I was like, look at all these Reddit trolls just like messing with marketers, brand advertising dollars.
That's really good. One thing that I think would be just quite interesting to maybe wrap things up is just, you've always had quite a strong profile, and obviously, I say always, everyone starts from zero. So I think it'd be interesting. This almost feels like a podcast episode in itself, but just to hear what you think are the big factors of influence. So even to the point of maybe how you prioritize your day, of how do you focus time around social media, blogging, podcasting? Where do you find the most value these days?
Yeah, that's a good question. So in terms of where I focus, I try and run everything in my professional and personal life through just two channels, my email and my calendar.
Right.
Honestly, I get annoyed when I see text messages or phone calls or LinkedIn or Twitter DMs or all those kinds of things. I'm like, oh, I got to figure, I got to answer those two. I think someone pointed out to me, a friend pointed out to me a few months ago that I hadn't checked my Facebook messages in like 6 years. And so I was going back through, I'm like, oh, Will Reynolds is so sweet. I think he wished me happy birthday for like 4 years in a row and I never noticed.
Yeah, I'm still 30.
Exactly. But I like that just because it gives me a lot of focus. Like it gives me the ability to focus, which is great. Mm-hmm. In terms of where I get a lot of value from putting myself out there, I think the most value I get absolutely is blogging, right? Yeah. Blogging on our site, writing on SparkToro, that brings us, not just traffic, but sort of subscribers and amplification and new followers and people being aware of what we do. A good percentage of people, it's not high, it's probably 5-10%, but will go read a blog post. And if they haven't tried SparkToro yet, they'll go at least look at the homepage or the product page.
Right, okay, yeah.
Which is exactly what we need, right? Like we need people to know what we do. Yeah. To start down the process of the funnel. And second to that, because I'm trying to reach web marketers, LinkedIn is my second most valuable sort of place to contribute. And then Twitter very close behind, because marketers are just very active on Twitter.
Yeah.
And so that's pretty useful. I've done some experiments with Instagram, kind of trying to use it a little more professionally and post some stuff there. It kind of works. I think if I wanted to, I could probably start to invest there. My sense is there's younger, less English language centric audience that is on Instagram that consumes marketing content there.
Yeah.
So it doesn't have no value, but it's not quite right for.
I know what you mean. I did use Instagram quite a lot, and I found that actually, maybe it's the whole like social dilemma. I don't know if you've seen the Netflix show, Social Dilemma, but it feels like getting hooked onto, I'm just scrolling through stuff and consuming as opposed to creating. And I think actually it's what you're saying is much better, where it's you're writing an article. I think it's good to hear that blogging is so valuable, because I almost wonder, I used to blog quite prolifically, I would say 10 years ago, like once a week without fail for the likes of e-consultancy, our own blog. And then I got busy, and I think it's one of those that I've made excuses. I've then said, okay, I'll wait until I have inspiration to write, and that doesn't happen. I need to block out time and prioritize and protect that time. But I much rather have kind of the thought of deep content is what really works, because I think too often we can think about this, I wouldn't call it shallow content, but certainly micro content in the forms of tweets, LinkedIn, etc. And there's not always that much depth behind it, but it gets a lot of engagement. And I think there's a place for that, but I think I would much rather back it up with, here's a big piece that I put a lot of thinking into, and I've done over the last couple of weeks, I've done a couple of 2,000 word articles. It's the first time I've done that in a long time. And I think some of it now relates to obviously your social audience behind it. Obviously with SparkToro, you're starting from ground zero again, to certain respect, but you bring with you your social influence and following that means that if you didn't have that, it would obviously be much harder as well. So it's how do you leverage everything together?
No, I feel really lucky to have had at least my Twitter and LinkedIn account when I left Moz. I think those have created a ton of value, and they're transferable, right? Which
Exactly. It's interesting. Even going back to the money point of, I can't remember who said this, but it was on the with Joe Rogan, and he said if Joe Rogan's net worth today was wiped down to zero, by next year, he'd be rich, if not sooner, because he's got the influence, he's got the audience. And it's right now, that's actually much more powerful if you can then leverage that in the right way. And like you're saying, this, I like the analogy of wealth is like a magnifying glass. If you're a good person, you can magnify the good that you're doing. If you're a bad person, it magnifies the bad. And I think it's not that what you're doing, whether that's wealth or social audience, is good or bad. It's what you do with that yourself to amplify your message.
Yeah, I like that analogy a lot. That resonates with me.
Perfect. Okay. I think that's a good place to leave it, because there's a lot of good stuff in there. And yeah, happily share this, because like I say, I think it's one of those where I'm genuinely interested to hear more about what you're up to and what the tool does. And yeah, I'm sure a lot of other people will be too. So thanks a lot for that.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much for having me on, Kevin. I really appreciate it. And take care of yourself. I'm going to go try and get some sleep.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, thanks for doing this late at night.
No problem. Thanks for doing it early. Take care.
Thanks, Ryan.